Good afternoon. Thanks for joining us, and we'll dive right in. I'd like to try and finish with plenty of time for answering questions at the end. So we're going to talk about new diagnostic criteria for probable Alzheimer's disease, but to do so we need to look at what we've been using for the last 20 plus years, and these are the NIN-CDS and ADRDA criteria for probable Alzheimer's disease. To begin with, using these criteria, the patient in question has to have dementia, meaning there's been a change in their cognition and it's severe enough that they can no longer handle day-to-day functions. For probable Alzheimer's disease, we need to see deficits in two or more cognitive domains. Usually memory is the first, but it doesn't need to be. So these could be memory and language, for example, or memory and visual spatial skills. And then we do at some point need to see decline in memory as well as other realms. So even if they start with, say, language problems and visual spatial problems, at some point we need to see progressive decline in memory and other realms as well. And this can't be in the setting of a disturbance of consciousness or delirium. So obviously we would make a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease, for example, in a hospital setting. The age range is pretty broad, so ages 40 to 90. Most of what we see in sporadic Alzheimer's disease, of course, veers towards the higher end. 65 and up, but there are certainly earlier onset cases that we want to be vigilant and on the lookout for. And most importantly, there can't be any other explanation for the patient's presentation, and that brings up the differential diagnosis, which we'll get to in a few slides. In terms of what the American Academy of Neurology recommends for the workup of dementia, currently, the recommendation is that anybody coming with memory complaints or cognitive complaints that are insidious should be screened for B12 deficiency and thyroid disorders. So we send a B12 and TSH on everyone. RPR is actually no longer sort of rotely added to this panel. We do still worry about tertiary syphilis, but we hold off on sending RPR unless we have more clinical suspicion, such as a previous history of STD or syphilis in particular. The problem with RPRs are a lot of false positives, and you end up having to chase things down that probably don't fit the clinical picture. So B12 and TSH on everybody, and syphilis screen as indicated. The yield on these is very low. I'm not sure I've ever convincingly picked up anybody with any of these disorders presenting in the Stanford Center for Memory Disorders Clinic. The recommendation for imaging is that everybody should get a brain image done. It can either be a routine head CT or an MRI. Assuming there are no contraindications to MR imaging, such as a pacemaker, we routinely get MRI just because it has better spatial resolution and better coverage of the posterior fossa. But the truth is, reasonably high quality routine head CT, even without contrast, is sufficient for screening. It's important to screen for depression, and this is very difficult to do in, say, a 45-minute or 1-hour encounter. But that's a common mimic of dementia. And the AAN doesn't specify which neuropsychological measures should be incorporated, but they certainly encourage the use of neuropsychology. And again, for many of us, this is a luxury that is afforded to people that work at academic centers, but that might be harder to do in the community setting. But it's incredibly useful. As low-tech as it is, it's among the most sensitive measures that we have. And importantly, the AAN back in 2001 recommended against a whole host of procedures that were done at some centers but not at others, and that ultimately they felt at the time didn't really hold up to scrutiny in terms of sensitivity and specificity. And as we'll talk about, at least the CSF studies and some specific PET studies have now sort of made the grade. So this has raised this sort of model of a march of biomarkers, sort of when do different biomarkers become abnormal. This is work from Cliff Jack and colleagues at the Mayo, and over a number of studies and looking at these biomarkers over years, this is the model that's generally been upheld, where in red we see amyloid imaging and/or amyloid levels in the spinal fluid is the first marker, while subjects are still cognitively normal, that tends to become elevated if you're looking at amyloid deposition. This is followed in blue by tau. As patients begin to move towards the MCI stage here, you'll start to see tau levels rise. Things like hippocampal volume loss are much less sensitive and really only start to become apparent once people have become symptomatic. Things like memory testing and clinical function start to change even later in the clinical course. So the notion is that amyloid changes precede tau changes, which precede structural changes, cognitive changes, and clinical changes. Basically, we have new criteria that are certainly already in use in the research domain, and I think will slowly, gradually make their way into the clinical setting as people become more comfortable with these biomarkers. And the new Alzheimer's disease criteria, these are proposed by a working group from the NIA and the Alzheimer's Association, published in 2011, essentially depend on using the same clinical criteria. So somebody who meets probable Alzheimer's disease by the clinical criteria I reviewed at the beginning of the talk, and then adding information that we get from biomarkers. So now we have probable Alzheimer's disease, and we can have uninformative biomarkers, meaning either that they aren't available, they weren't acquired, or that they're conflicting or indeterminate, the assays weren't sufficient. So that's not very informative, that's probable Alzheimer's disease by clinical criteria alone. We can have probable Alzheimer's disease with an intermediate probability of Alzheimer's disease pathology, and this is the case where, say, the tau markers here in the far column are positive, but the amyloid markers either weren't tested or were indeterminate. You can have the reverse case where maybe somebody has a positive amyloid imaging scan, but we have no information about tau because CSF wasn't sampled. And then the sort of most clear-cut case where they meet the clinical criteria for Alzheimer's disease and both biomarkers are positive. That is, they have evidence for positive amyloid biomarkers and positive tau biomarkers. You'll note when you look at this third column that tau is only one of the features that's listed among neuronal injury. I think, for my money, tau is the most reliable and informative, but in these criteria, they included things like FDG PET, reduced metabolism, or hippocampal volume loss on structural MRI as other indicators of neuronal injury. Those are much less readily quantified, in my opinion. So I really imagine using these criteria, thinking only about CSF levels of tau. And then just as important, here's somebody who might meet criteria for Alzheimer's disease, but has the lowest possibility of having the pathology. If you say sample CSF, they have normal beta amyloid levels and normal tau levels. This makes Alzheimer's disease very unlikely as the cause of the person's dementia. You can take the same approach and apply it to mild cognitive impairment. And so in the near future, we'll probably be talking about patients that meet the core clinical criteria for mild cognitive impairment, but have an intermediate biomarker probability of underlying Alzheimer's pathology. And let's say their beta amyloid imaging scan was positive, but we didn't sample their CSF. Or mild cognitive impairment with a high likelihood of being due to Alzheimer's disease shown here, where we sampled their spinal fluid, they have low amyloid levels and high tau levels, and we can say with a pretty high degree of certainty that this is mild cognitive impairment that's on its way to full-blown Alzheimer's disease. And again, just as with somebody who's already got dementia, somebody who's in the mild cognitive impairment stage, if you sample their spinal fluid and find that their beta amyloid levels are normal, and that their tau levels are normal, you should really think about other potential underlying neurodegenerative diseases that are causing the mild cognitive impairment. In terms of what the American Academy of Neurology recommends for the workup of dementia, currently the recommendation is that anybody coming with memory complaints or cognitive complaints that are insidious should be screened for B12 deficiency and thyroid disorders. So we send a B12 and TSH on everyone. RPR is actually no longer sort of rotely added to this panel. We do still worry about tertiary syphilis, but we hold off on sending RPR unless we have more clinical suspicion, such as a previous history of STD or syphilis in particular. The problem with RPRs are a lot of false positives, and you end up having to chase things down that probably don't fit the clinical picture. So B12 and TSH on everybody and syphilis screen, as indicated. The yield on these is very low. I'm not sure I've ever convincingly picked up anybody with any of these disorders presenting in the Stanford Center for Memory Disorders Clinic. The recommendation for imaging is that everybody should get a brain image done. It can either be a routine head CT or an MRI. Assuming there are no contraindications to MR imaging, such as a pacemaker, we routinely get MRI just because it has better spatial resolution and better coverage of the posterior fossa. But the truth is, reasonably high quality routine head CT, even without contrast, is sufficient for screening. It's important to screen for depression, and this is very difficult to do in, say, a 45-minute or 1-hour encounter, but that's a common mimic of dementia. And the AAN doesn't specify which neuropsychological measures should be incorporated, but they certainly encourage the use of neuropsychology. And again, for many of us, this is a luxury that is afforded to people that work at academic centers, but that might be harder to do in the community setting. But it's incredibly useful. As low-tech as it is, it's among the most sensitive measures that we have. And importantly, the AAN back in 2001 recommended against a whole host of procedures that were done at some centers but not at others, and that ultimately they felt at the time didn't really hold up to scrutiny in terms of sensitivity and specificity. And as we'll talk about, at least the CSF studies and some specific PET studies have now sort of made the grade. And this is very difficult to do in, say, a 45-minute or 1-hour encounter, but that's a common mimic of dementia. And the AAN doesn't specify which neuropsychological measures should be incorporated, but they certainly encourage the use of neuropsychology. And again, for many of us, this is a luxury that is afforded to people that work at academic centers, but that might be harder to do in the community setting. But it's incredibly useful. As low-tech as it is, it's among the most sensitive measures that we have. And importantly, the AAN back in 2001 recommended against a whole host of procedures that were done at some centers but not at others, and that ultimately they felt at the time didn't really hold up to scrutiny in terms of sensitivity and specificity. And as we'll talk about, at least the CSF studies and some specific PET studies have now sort of made the grade.